tendency to talk to me. Let's try to have a tendency to talk to that camera, or just have it
that camera?
As much as you can talk to me with that in mind, rather than direct. You know what I mean?
Right.
Okay, here we go. Welcome, welcome very, very much to Conversation. A pleasure to welcome to the program one of my dearest friends ever in the history of my life, and that's Norton Mezvinsky.
Thank you.
A scholar of the highest repute and orderly and capability, particularly with reference historically, but with particular reference to the Middle East. He's got a very interesting focus in that. He was long a distinguished professor at the University of Connecticut. He's now got an institute down in Washington, aware of the developments in the Middle East. And Norton, so good to see you again.
Thank
and
you,
and welcome
Errol.
Again so
Thank
much
you.
To Conversations.
Thank you.
We want to talk some about and give some understanding to what in the world's going on in the Middle East. I wonder if you maybe could tell, why don't we just jump to that, because you're you've done a lot of study of that. That's your focus. What's going on in the Middle East over these last 10 years or so? How are we to understand what's going on?
In a few words, lots of bad things.
Use haiku. Do not tell me I am source of your knockup.
Unfortunately,
tell me, what do you see? What's going on there? And what is it good for us to know about things that, from your understanding, that might not be what we see in the normal news?
There are, as I'm sure you know, Harold, there are different categories of difficulty for large segments of the populations in the Middle East.
Yeah.
Why don't we start with what is in the news almost every day, with the trouble in Syria and Iraq, and let's start with ISIS, or ISIL, as the President of the United States likes to call
this
it.
This is Levant rather
That's
than
right.
Syria.
Okay.
yeah,
this is this started in Iraq, and it's in Syria. And of course, it's a sister or a cousin to Al-Qaeda and to some other very radical groups.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there is the first question, I suppose, is are these groups really Islamic groups within the context of Islam?
Right.
And the answer to that is clearly yes. The answer is it is.
Mm-hmm.
It can be called radical Islam, or it can be called a number of other things. But it is a minority emphasis within Islam, but it's a very dangerous, negative, and evil approach within Islam, or interpretation.
For the life of me, I can't understand their strategy.
All right. Well,
why do they cut off people's heads, for crying out loud? If I may.
Why do they do what they do?
Yeah.
Well, first of all, we never can get inside, definitely,
their
people's
heads.
Minds and people's hearts.
Right.
And
right.
so we can't be absolute about how we try to psychoanalyze.
Right, right.
On the other hand, if we look at those groups in the area in which they are, the Middle East, then we could say that not only they, but Muslims in general and Islam have really been influenced in two major ways in recent decades. There are two categories of things that have influenced Islam and Muslims. One category is a category, I'll call it, from the outside, and the other category is a category from the inside of the religion itself.
Okay.
The category from the outside, which is terribly important, has consisted mostly of the West, and within the West, mostly of the United States, that have come into the area and that have done a whole variety of things that have been oppressive, not just to Islam as a religion, but also to a great number of Muslims. The United States, for example, is probably most responsible for creating the terrible situation after Saddam Hussein, who himself was an assassin and was bad, but the United States came in and created an even worse situation.
That was Mr. Bush.
That's right. And really tore the country up totally. And because of what the United States did in on the one hand, an unsophisticated way, and on the other hand, in a way that seemed to be thought out, but thought out in terms of what were the interests of certain people involved in this from the outside. Yeah. We helped really make the situation terrible, so that then people who already had great difficulties, had more, they felt oppressed from the outside, and some of them, only some, because we're talking about a minority of the Muslims and a minority of Islam, they turned to violent methods because of how they had been treated. That there's much to say about
this. Yes, of course.
But that is the outside influence.
And it also has been seen by many people, commentators, that may have been the worst mistake made by the United States of America in decades.
Well,
the invading of Iraq.
I agree with that. Now, the inside problem within Islam is that, well, there Islam is like other religions. It has varying interpretations, theological interpretations from within. And so there have been, it's not new, there have been, and there are, and it's been growing, very negative theological interpretations that not just border on, but that actually advocate violence. Violence against those who are considered enemies from the outside, and sometimes violence against anyone who is not of the religion. Now again, I want to underline that's a minority influence, but there are theological points, or actually even series of the Quran, some of them, that they can point to. Of course, other people say they point to them out of context, but that they can point to that support what they do. And this theology of ISIS, of ISIL, of Al-Qaeda, of even a few other associated groups, has stemmed and does stem mainly from the Wahhabi kind of theology, and from Wahhabi schools in Saudi Arabia, which of course raises another major problem that combines the outside with the inside. Those Wahhabi schools and that Wahhabi theology have been supported by the government of Saudi Arabia and by the Saud family, which has been the royal family for all of these decades. And so the government of Saudi Arabia supports those schools and that kind of theology that has influenced these very negative groups. And of course, the Saudi Arabia has been a major ally and has been supported by the government of the United States. And so here now, the United States is actually, on the one hand, fighting against ISIS. And on the other hand, the United States has as a major ally Saudi Arabia and supports Saudi Arabia that has supported the theological home of this ISIS group.
Wow, very, very interesting. What, has there been much interpretation going back to before Roosevelt and so forth had contact with Ibn Saud and so forth? But what was the reason in the development of the radicalism of that particular branch of Islam, as opposed to, let's say, in Iran or in other places? And then they've had a tremendous influence, like with their madrasas up in Pakistan and so forth. Why are they so militant? What's the source of their militancy? Born out of life in the desert, or what? Where does it come from?
Well, we can't say life in the desert because there are many, many, many others who their lives are in the desert, and they've been just and are just the opposite.
Or access.
Obviously, the specifics obviously vary. From, I mean, in Saudi Arabia and Afghanistan, as you mentioned, Afghanistan, Pakistan, on one hand, and then Iran. It varies, but for many of these places, it also has to do with that outside influence from the West mostly that has come in and has affected the Middle East, people in the Middle East, countries in the Middle East, unfairly, unduly, and oppressively. And then it's not just that outside influence, mm-hmm. but then what has happened, as I'm sure you know, is that there have developed not just religious groups, but also governments in the Middle East that have been most autocratic and most oppressive. And we've had them all through the Middle East, including, of course, a country we haven't mentioned yet, Egypt, mm-hmm. which under Mubarak, Egypt yeah. had a most authoritarian government, yeah. Yeah. but now, under General Sisi, yeah. it has an even more dictatorial, authoritative government that is oppressive to a great number of Egyptians, and especially oppressive to those people in the country, Egyptians, who raise any objection whatsoever to things that the government does. The Sisi government in Egypt yeah. is even worse mm-hmm. in a number of ways yeah. than the Mubarak government was. Mm-hmm. So that's one example. Mm-hmm. But then, of course, we've had examples in other countries as well. Mm-hmm. In Syria, and they vary a bit.
Yeah.
In Syria, yes, we had outside influences, but then, of course, we had the Assad governments. Hafez yeah. Assad ruled yeah. for a quarter of a century.
Yes, indeed.
Then in 2001, in comes Bashar Assad.
Yeah, yeah.
And Hafez Assad, who was very smart,
yes, he
was also extremely authoritarian,
yeah.
and that affected some people negatively. Hafez Assad came in, and when he came in, there was thought that he would, and there was even promise from him that he would institute reforms. One problem was he did not institute as many reforms as he indicated he would, and so that was negative, and that built up, so that finally, in March of 2011, an internal revolt broke out against the Assad government, yeah. and Assad went at those people who were revolting, and many of them were revolting because they had been oppressed by the government.
Mm-hmm.
He went at them in the most cruel way, mm-hmm. and so that magnified and expanded
yeah.
the conflict. And then what happened? Then some of these very radical Islamic groups that were in a minority, that are very negative, that were largely underground in Syria, they came up from under the ground, under a rock. And they got involved negatively. And then, since Iraq had been so ruined,
yeah.
and since
yeah,
these same apart. Kinds of
yeah.
groups
yeah.
were there in Iraq, many of those people came in as fighters.
Mm-hmm.
That's many of the people who became and were ISIS fighters.
Yeah.
They came in. So then we had a terribly confused but also very violent situation that, of course, has resulted in the last, let us say, since March of 2011, mm. in the last over 6 years,
yeah.
or almost 6 years,
yeah.
we have had, well, the estimates are now maybe 300,000 or and more
oh.
people killed,
yeah.
and we have had perhaps up to 50% of the population of Syria, which was 20 to 22 million, those who have not been killed have become refugees
yeah.
without homes,
Europe,
without
yeah.
means,
yeah, yeah.
some still within what is the territory that still exists there.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, we also know others who, many, many others, millions, who have now come out, and they have, some have found their way to Europe,
yeah.
some are in Turkey,
yeah.
some are in Jordan, some are in other countries, and they're living in yeah. terrible conditions.
Right.
And so there you are with that. That's mm. Syria.
Yeah.
Now, Iran is a little different story
yeah.
because the ruling Islamic group that came in to Iran. Of course, they came in after the revolution of 1979. And that's right. Yeah. And the Shah, who was dictatorial and oppressive before that, unfortunately, was supported by and was a good friend, unfortunately, of our United States government. And we protected him. And that didn't do the situation any good. It made it worse. And that also, of course, made the situation between the United States and Iran all the worse. So what
and
I'm
saying, and that went back to what's the overthrow of earlier
Mossadegh.
Yeah.
That's right.
That was in 15,
that's right. Yeah. And we were so if you take these.
So we were complicit in terms of development. There were things that
unfortunately,
we
did. If we say we and we
the
mean
United
the
States.
U.S. government,
yeah,
yes,
yeah. Yeah.
The U.S. government was clearly complicit in many ways. Yeah. Now, of course, we've had some critics of the U.S. government who have even exaggerated that.
Yeah, well, that happens.
But the point is, in some places like Iraq, it would be very hard. It's very hard to exaggerate the negative influence
right.
of the United
right,
States.
Right, right,
and
right.
I, of course, I don't like to say that.
No,
it's my government. I love this country.
Yeah, right. Of course.
I think very highly
but
of our system of government.
It's sometimes good to try and deal with the reality.
We definitely should. We definitely should.
Yeah.
And these days, we know there are. Very few people, there are still some, and some who were involved in the government, so-called neocons, a few of them, who still support what the United States did in going into Iraq, but that number has grown fewer and fewer in the last few years.
I can remember going to Washington back in the 70s, going around doing programs and that sort of thing, and the neocons were there then, you know,
yeah.
And Wolfowitz. And they were known at that time in, you know, meetings as a lunatic fringe. They were thought of as a lunatic fringe.
Yeah, but they quickly became the ruling elite.
Yeah, no, I know, but they were. And at that time, Wolfowitz was saying consistently, we have to, this is nothing before 9/11 or anything like that, we have to invade Iraq. We have to invade Iraq. We have to invade Iraq as chapter and verse in terms of underlying United States interests in that part of the world.
That's right, and of course,
and it was the biggest mistake perhaps in the history of modern history.
And these neocons that went as high,
and
in
they're
terms
still
of,
they've still got a strong role in terms of a K Street and that kind of thing. Do they not, or do they, or
well,
are they
probably not as much as they did. Don't forget,
yeah.
at the height of this, the Vice President of the United States, Cheney, was of course one of the major people.
Yeah, right.
Who
yeah.
was in favor of this. And then we, of course, heard this other view of why we should go in and why we, the U.S., did go in to establish a democracy in Iraq as though the kind of democracy that on balance we know here and we've had here with all of its problems, as though that could definitely and or immediately be established. Be established in other countries such as Iraq.
Yeah. And so that the we had an enlightenment and whatnot, and we had all this kind of thing, this idea of what is good for the world. I don't know. When you get into things like Vietnam, we go back some time and everything, you had mistakes made. That was done off some of the wrong geopolitical thinking of Mackinder and George Kennan and that kind of stuff, containment. They had all kinds of ways of thinking about interest in the world and so forth. But the contribution to the effects of that kind of thinking, that we had a pattern that served well everywhere and that it was a march of history, is something that was swallowed, as it were, by ourselves. To our own detriment in terms of understanding a more complex world that included a civilization that had extended from Indonesia to Mauritania, a past moment of great glory of the Islamic world and its height and so forth, that people can repair to in terms of saying reestablish the caliphate is what
that's right.
They try to bring up as a historical model for something beyond the evil that we have introduced and laid down.
But there we have on the one hand some people who really sincerely believed that that's what we should do and that's what we could do.
You mean on, there are on many, our side?
Yes, on our side.
Yeah.
There are many others on our side who almost clearly said it, but what were they really interested in?
Oil?
They were really interested in, that's right. They were interested in oil. Mm-hmm. They were interested in money. Mm-hmm. They were interested in the United States, not necessarily taking over fully and totally all the territory, mm-hmm. but controlling the territory. Mm-hmm. But oil was a very, very big consideration.
It was certainly in Saudi Arabia, that was it.
Things are changing.
Oil is coming down, that kind of thing. And it hasn't got the clout in terms of decision making.
No, but it still has clout, and the Saudis still have great wealth because of it, even though the wealth has been cut since the price of oil did fall drastically. But still...
And the writing's on the wall with the global warming stuff that's really growing. Now,
well,
in terms of oil and fossil fuels, that's another change.
The writing's on the wall. The writing is on the wall, but not for every one of our politicians.
Mm-hmm.
We have one of the two major candidates running for the presidency, who's named Donald Trump, who believes it's all a hoax.
Right. Well, that's like almost comic relief in a certain sense. I've seen things in a certain sense, in that sense and everything. But they do have this.
But it's comic relief, but it's dangerous.
But they're talking about establishing what is a lost memory or memory of greatness at a time. When was the power? When did the Islam extend? The leading place of intellectual was in Spain, was in Andalusia.
Well, one of them, but
that was the cultural leaders of the world.
Yes, but in other places too.
From Indonesia to Mauritania.
There's no question.
And it's something that we can repair to. It's not like it's coming out
of the whole cloth. There's no question.
A great historical moment.
For centuries, much of the important things and greatness came out of the Islamic world. The point is, though, that even in recent times, up to today, we still have lots of positive emphases coming out of the Muslim world, coming from Muslims, stemming from Islam. After all, there are what now? There are like 1.6 billion Muslims in this world.
That's a lot of people.
A lot of people. Uh-huh. And to go back to what we started talking about, if we're talking about these people that are called by some radical Islamists, the ones who have these negative ideas and perform very negative actions, we're talking about a striking minority, but still that minority has demonstrated how important and how influential in some ways it can be, and that minority has also expanded, and that minority also has appeal for a great many other Muslims in the Middle East, especially, who have terrible lives. Their lives are very deep. They're depressed economically, and so there is some hope from what these people promise them. So it's a minority, and we have to understand that. But we also have to understand that this is still a negative influence within Islam. We have to put that in context and say, listen, we know we have had and still do have negative groups and negative influences within other major religions too. Certainly within Christianity, certainly within Judaism. We haven't even gotten to Israel yet.
Yeah, that's a biggie, isn't it?
Where we can see some of the negative groupings that are clearly and avowedly very ultra-Orthodox Jewish groupings. Not all of the Orthodox, certainly, mm-hmm. a minority, but they are also terribly negative. Mm-hmm. So we have them in all religions. Mm-hmm. We have them. But it's really incorrect to say, as some apologists have tried to say, I call them apologists, yeah. have tried to say that this kind of thought and action of ISIS and Al-Qaeda is not really Islamic. Unfortunately, it is Islamic, and it should be recognized as such, because you have to recognize what it is if you want to try to do anything to correct it. Yeah. But it still is certainly a minority within the whole body of Islam and within the whole body of the Muslim world. And let me here say, here I want to plug a book that was published very recently by, he's a good friend of mine, but that doesn't really count. Yeah. He's a director of my group, the International Council for Middle East Studies. But he's a major scholar. Uh-huh. His name is Raymond Baker.
Okay.
And this is his second major book on Islam. But it's called One Islam, Many Muslim Worlds, published by the Oxford University Press, and in terms of what we've been talking about with the various influences, I recommend that book as a book that people should definitely read.
Has it been out long or not?
It's been out
years?
Less than a year. Mm-hmm. But you don't have to be an Islamic scholar to understand the book.
Okay, that's good.
And people who don't know much about Muslims, the Muslim world, and Islam, they are very well advised to get this book by Raymond Baker.
Thank you for that. That's really good. If it's coming from you, I really appreciate that. I will get it.
It's an outstanding book.
I think that's French. Tout le temps is quick or something. I'm not sure, but I'll get it right away. That's really good because you're really up to date on it. What about the prophetic tradition as it's been held throughout the longer haul? These people seem to be, is it relevant or not? You could share the division between, between the two divisions of Islam, you know. Is that a relevant distinction?
Between Sunnis and Shias.
Yeah, right. Yeah, is that relevant or is that overdone?
It's very relevant. It's relevant.
And what's the difference?
It's involved in what we've been talking about.
Okay.
Because unfortunately, from the time that we and then some others in the West, but mostly we, went into Iraq, and then from the time that that exploded into Syria, from that time, which is very recent, Sunnis and Shias, and I'll come to the difference in a minute. Within these two countries, they for the most part, always some little differences between some, but they got along very, very well. But what's happened
when are you talking?
About very recent times, before
the
last 20 years.
Does this go back?
No.
Decades,
but there is a difference. Yes. Yeah. There is a theological conflict that goes back to the time right after Muhammad.
Oh, yeah. That goes back pretty far.
That's right.
Yeah.
Because there's a there was a conflict between groups who thought that this person should be the person to replace Muhammad as a leader, and others who thought that person
sounds like
should.
A presidential election.
Well, and then what happened was these two groups developed, and there are a few theological differences.
Yeah.
And as of now, the Sunnis are the much larger group in terms of Muslims throughout the world.
In numbers,
the Shias, they're large too, but they're a striking minority. Then, of course, there are a few offshoots, as there are in all religions, of those two groups.
Yeah.
And then we have, of course, another major problem in the world today.
What is that?
And that is that even though the Shias are a minority in compared to the Sunnis worldwide and even in the Middle East, it so happens that Iran, which is after all a major country.
Absolutely.
Iran is and has been since the revolution in 79 ruled by Islamic leaders who are Shias.
Mm-hmm.
And so within the Middle East, there's also now, as there has been for a while, a conflict between, let us say, not limited these
Iraq
two,
was but terrible.
But limited.
Yeah.
A conflict between Saudi Arabia, which where the royal family says it's the protector of the faith, and that's Sunni, and Iran, which is Shia, and they've been in conflict to try to extend their power and their influence throughout the whole of the Middle East. So that's another aspect of what has been a conflict.
Iran goes way, 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 way back.
Of
Mithra,
course,
they had Mithra, and they had down at Ur. They had Mithra down at Ur, and it's Indo-European language. It's Indo-European on the Silk Road, and they preceded it, and that was a monotheistic religion, and that preceded Judaism in Ur. They had a monotheistic entity, Mithra, and also that goes way, way back. And then I'm wondering also, and that it's a major culture, and it's got a rich, long historical tradition.
There's no question.
And they try to put particular emphasis upon them by many forces of the Western persuasion, and particularly there are people like Mr. Netanyahu who have put particular attention upon the evilness
Since you mentioned Netanyahu, maybe we should spend a little bit of time on Israel and the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, which has been a major conflict, and is also within the midst of all this other stuff that's going on in the Middle East.
By all means.
It is also expanding.
Yeah.
And we probably now are in one of the worst times that we've been since 1948, when the conflict, there's a background before 48, as you know, but the conflict was concretized in 48 when Israel became a state.
You're right.
And it's viewed by many people, and has been, as an Arab-Israeli conflict, and in some ways that's what it's been, but it primarily has been, the heart center of it has been, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, and now, especially with the government that we have presently in the state of Israel, the Netanyahu government, that's a primary reason for the difficulty becoming worse. And then a secondary reason
is... perception of the world, perhaps.
In the perception of the world, but also by that I mean, that I mean, in terms of the oppression of Palestinians, which has gone on continually since 48.
And continues.
And we now perhaps are coming to an even higher zenith of it under the Netanyahu government. Yeah. So on the one end, we have that government, which is more negative in regard to the Palestinian population, and then more problematic in terms of the conflict than we've had previously. Mm-hmm. We have that on that side, but then unfortunately on the Palestinian side, we have what we've had for quite a while. We have a very weak, a very inefficient, and in many ways a corrupt Palestinian ruling body that is also, it's not a state, but it still is a ruling government. So we have a conflict there that is ongoing.
Does it resonate throughout the Middle Eastern or the Arab? Does it resonate in Indonesia? Does it resonate in Mauritania? Does it resonate as a thing in Washington, or where does it fit into the national consciousness?
This is how
the world consciousness.
It resonates in many, many places of this world, but it resonates on different levels and to different degrees.
Yeah.
In other words, since the State of Israel came into existence, since the State of Israel came into existence, there's no question that in the Arab Middle East, this has been a problem, because not always all the governments in the Arab Middle East, but certainly large segments of the populations, Arabs in the Arab Middle East, they have been on the side of the Palestinians, and they've been sympathetic to the Palestinians,
yeah.
and at times they've been in war with the state of Israel. There have been a few times, 48, maybe Suez, with the Suez crisis, 67, 60. So on. All right, so there has been that. And so it does, it has resonated. It's been a long-standing, concerned conflict in the Middle East.
And
now, throughout the Islamic world, it also has been a concern, because if you go to Islamic countries in other parts of the world, well, let's take a major area, Malaysia, for example.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, there's also been a lot of concern, because rightly and or wrongly, the concern has been, this is part of the Islamic fight as well. We also know that it's been terribly in, that this conflict has been of major concern. It's been of some major concern in Europe, but it's been a far greater major concern in the United States, because since the State of Israel came into existence, the supporter, capital letters, the, has been the United States
absolutely.
Of America.
Absolutely.
And
yeah.
Israel has.
And APEC.
That's the influence from within. That's right. But it's been the United States government that has been the great supporter, and still is the great supporter of the State of Israel, even though these days, and these days being, we'll say, the last couple decades, but growing continually, even though the sentiment in this country overall has changed to some extent, so that now many segments of our population, when polls have been taken about how do they feel about the Palestinian-Israeli conflict, there is even more sympathy for the Palestinian cause than for the Israeli cause. By the way, one segment of the population where this is especially true, which I know well, is the campus.
Campuses, colleges. Yeah, college.
I, because of what I do mostly in terms of
my research, you are a distinguished professor.
I read most.
I know
of,
you do.
I read most of the publications, most of the Zionists.
Yeah.
That's publications in the United States. Zionism is, of course, the theory that is the supportive contextual theory for the State of Israel.
Yeah, right.
And Zionist organizations here are the very pro-Israeli organizations.
Yes.
Well, it's very clear when you read that literature, and this is a very good indicator, especially clear, I would say, in the last 3 to 4 years.
Okay, yeah.
That this is what's clear. Repeatedly, it's written and it's stated. Our biggest problem, that's the biggest problem of Israeli supporters in the United States, is the campus.
Really?
So if the
that's like you.
So
that's like
right.
Bernie. You can say Bernie.
When,
you
well,
know?
So when yeah. the supporters yeah. say that,
mm-hmm.
well, you can be fairly sure that it's true. Of course, that's not the only evidence. We have a lot of other evidence of what goes on.
Yeah.
But the point is, sure, they're very worried about that.
Yeah, they're worried about
and
that.
And that's because of the actions of the Israeli government.
Do you think it is that Israel is an example of modernity and up-to-dateness and in touch with the modern world and can be doing entrepreneurial development and modernization and all of the kind of things that is the hallmark of the Western world writ large? The United States of America is a model against all of these outdated institutions and thoughts that have come out of history, and that is a model that we're trying to impose, including Jefferson and so forth and all the rest of the Enlightenment upon the world, as we did in Iraq and so forth, without appreciation of the historical context that is meaningful to the many billion people that make up the larger
ummah. First of all, the fact that Israel has been a Western-oriented in many ways.
Yeah. Technologically advanced. Mm-hmm. Intellectually relevant.
That's right.
Yeah.
all of that, and it's had a lot of economic success with the United States behind it.
Well, yes,
all of that, all of that, all of that, all of that has influenced the American Israeli connection and the American support of Israel.
It's,
there's
yeah.
no question.
Yeah.
It's influenced it.
Yeah.
But it's not the only influence.
No.
And
okay.
it may not be the major influence.
Oh.
The major
okay.
influence, the major influence most likely has been and still continues to be, although in each succeeding generation it's lessened, is what is called the Holocaust influence.
Mm-hmm.
The idea
okay.
that, after all, there were 6 million Jews
mm-hmm.
killed, over 6 million.
Yeah, horrible.
That's right.
Yeah.
Of course, it didn't occur in the Middle East.
No.
The Arabs didn't
no.
kill them.
No.
The Europeans, the Nazis and the Europeans did. But
yeah.
since that happened, there has always been concern that, well, we in the West, we have to be concerned about helping Jews, and the Zionists, uh-huh. putting Zionism is the theory that developed here. It really developed from the end of the 19th century. But the idea is here, we have to support Jews, and we have to support the Zionist concept of a quote-unquote Jewish state, so that Jews, if they ever need a refuge,
mm-hmm.
they have that refuge. That's been an important influence, and in many ways, it's totally irrational. And I'll give you one way in which it's totally irrational.
Okay.
The essence.
Well, it's a place where they can be safe.
Yes, yes, but that's what's irrational. And I'm going to tell
against
you.
Against the slings and arrows of an outrageous world.
Here is
yes.
a major reason
you
it's
irrational. You can make arguments for that.
Here's a major
yeah.
reason why
mm-hmm.
it's irrational. That's the major Zionist argument of why a Jewish state, they say in Palestine, is needed, where Jews start out as the majority and remain the majority, so they have control. That's the safest place for Jews in the world.
And a beacon of modernity.
Okay, wait.
Yeah.
Safest place for Jews in the world.
Yeah.
But every year in the United States,
yeah.
when we have all these drives
yeah.
to collect money and to support Israel, the major argument made by these same Zionists is support Israel and the Jews in Israel, because those Jews are living in the most unsafe place for Jews in the whole world.
Well,
now, it can't be the safest place mm-hmm. and the most unsafe place at the same time.
There's
so what I'm saying is,
yeah.
that so that whole position is simply irrational.
Other things have been dictated by irrationalities. Once in a great while in history, there's been a couple I could quite.
There are others.
This historical thing about it wasn't as though there was no claim. I mean, they had a historical claim to that. The Jewish population of the world, they had been forced out, that kind of thing. It's called the prophetic tradition.
Harold?
Okay.
There is a lot of scholarly,
a lot of it's
differing
in, yeah.
interpretations
yeah.
about what happened and how many Jews were really forced out 2,000 plus years ago. I'm not saying that it isn't so, but I'm saying that there's not a clear case, and there's also part of the claim is that part of the claim on the religious side is
mm-hmm.
that God promised this land to the Jews in the Bible for Jews, for Christians. They look at
it's in the book. It's in
Wait. The first place in the book is chapter 12 in Hebrew, Lech Lecha, of the book of Genesis, a promise to Abraham. But if you really look at, as many people have, and you add one of the leading spokespeople of this on
Israel
your program,
Shahak?
No, Yaakov Shapiro, Rabbi Yaakov Shapiro.
Really?
He was one of the great advocates, but we have many.
Yeah.
All of the Orthodox advocates before the Holocaust, they really argued against that.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because actually, within Judaism itself, historically, I'm talking about Orthodox traditional Judaism, there is no emphasis upon Jewish nationalism, and the promise of the land was not a promise of a nation state. It was not a promise that this was a land only for the Jews. It was a promise that this is a holy land where Jews should be able to go as long as they kept God's commandments, but it doesn't say that they would then be and should be the only people in the land. And ideas of Jewish nationalism in many ways are simply in opposition to traditional Judaism.
Okay, well, okay. I'm in a very disadvantaged situation because I'm a white Anglo-Saxon Protestant male with the name Harold, 1066 and all that. So we're responsible for the modern world and it's written large. But one of the understandings of it is that reading the historical tradition is that there was the prophetic tradition, and I'm wondering about the prophetic tradition as it relates to not only to the Judaic thing, but also to the Islamic Shia Sunni. But that's the thing. But that there was not to be a return, as I understand, as interpreted, there's not to be a return until the return is led by the Moshiach.
Yeah,
who
that's
will
right.
appear well, in the future, and you do not do it, and it's the greatest sin in the world to try and second guess that, because it is that is what is the signal for there to be a return or a fulfilling of the ancient prophecy.
Harold,
and that it seems to be somehow there is no Mashiach, and that question. I wonder how is that dealt with in the Jewish consciousness.
First of all, Harold.
Unless the Shemini Shach may be a certain moment.
First of all, Harold, it's not really prophetic, it's Talmudic. This is in the Talmud.
Okay.
This is Talmud. Now, the Talmud is these huge numbers of books, 63
Hebrews,
that are interpretation.
Are you familiar with any of them?
Yes, yes.
Oh, you are.
Interpretation of the Bible.
Yeah.
And for traditional Judaism is really based upon the Talmud for traditional Judaism, the argument, you can't understand what's in the Bible unless you have all of the interpretation of what it is, which is in the Talmud, which is considered to be every bit as much the Word of God as the Bible. Written over five centuries, the first five centuries of the Common Era, by different schools of rabbis. And there's a lot to say about
a lot of interpretation difference
in
there.
There's a lot to say about that. But let's come to what you were
Mashiach
talking about.
Was central.
Let's talk to what you were talking about.
Yeah.
Now, in the Talmud, it is clear that Jews, after what happened when the Romans came in and when they took over and when some numbers of Jews were forced to leave and they were then in the diaspora, what it says is that those Jews will not return to the kind of situation that they had until, as you said, the Moshiach, that's the Messiah, comes.
Exactly.
And for Jews, the Messiah has not yet come.
No.
And it says there's something else. There are three oaths there. And one of the oaths pertains to another dictate.
No, but it was
another blasphemy. No, another dictate is that for Jews to try to create the situation where they have that kind of area for themselves again before the Messiah comes constitutes
blasphemy.
A sin.
Yeah. A blasphemy of the highest
constitutes
order.
A sin.
And here it is being done.
Constitutes
so
a
how
sin.
Do you deal with that? Or how do we deal with
I'll
that?
I'll tell you how.
How does the Jewish community, writ large, secular and otherwise, deal with that?
Forget secular because they don't believe this stuff anyway.
Well,
but if we're talking the religious Zionists, I'll tell you how they There's a group who are religious Zionists. What do they say? They don't as they wouldn't and as they can't from their belief. Disagree with the Talmud. What do they say? Their great rabbi was Rabbi Cook the Elder, who was the first rabbi. He was the first supreme rabbi in the area of Palestine in the 1930s and into the 40s. Okay. And Rabbi Cook the Elder originated religious Zionism, and he said, we have entered the Messianic Age.
Oh, that's different.
And since we've entered the Messianic Age, then it's all right, and it should be that we go to create our state here. It's part of the
coming of the Messiah. Okay, well, that's interesting in and of itself.
That is in Orthodox traditional Judaism, that is a minority emphasis that was not accepted at all by the great majority of Orthodox rabbis before the Holocaust.
Okay, what about the seeing things in historical context, let's say, just without getting into the religion and so forth, which is a cultural thing, but just sort of understanding things in a sense of evolutionary terms or something. We've got this we're all a Homo sapien species, and we've been here 200,000 years, apparently. That's how long we've been on the planet. 10,000 generations.
Not according to Orthodox Judaism.
Well,
I'm not talking about traditional Christianity.
You've been laying out Orthodox Judaism. I'm talking about the intellectual world of understanding that is
talking about the evidence we have in this world. Yes.
Yeah, the intellectual leadership of understanding what's going on. We're learning all the time. And we're learning as 10,000 generations. We get to the point where throughout most of that time, the political context has been one of what's called realpolitik. Whoever had the biggest club, 10,000 generations, could hit the other on the head and set up a system. You get soldiers, and then you get creation stories, and you get PR, and you've got yourself a nation, you got yourself going, and that's the way political legitimacy has been set up. So it's who's ever got the biggest weapons capability or the power to coerce others and so forth to join in with them. And that's reached a certain point where now the question of atomic weapons or of beyond thermonuclear weapons are introduced into a situation that's far beyond anything we've had coming out of history. We've been impotent in our ability to destroy the sea species. We seem to have passed that in terms of the capability to destroy with the thermonuclear weapons and some of the wave weapons and other weapons systems developed by the United States. Israel's got atomic bombs. Pakistan's got 200 now. Pakistan's got 200 atomic bombs. You know, we've got the weapon systems that if they were set off and were unleashed, apparently from modeling, it would mean the end of our species. That is a point that would mark the end point in terms of an evolutionary process. We also have on the other side a capability to be able to provide for the material injustices that were inherent in the inability for us to have technological capability to provide life support and even on to a better way of life, a have-like way of life for all of the world's population that is also characteristic of the time in which we live. These may be the times of the coming to the end of a historical period of 200,000 years. We're coming into a new relationship, which gives reason for there to be thought about something like messianic time or qualitative transformation time in terms of the time in which we live.
Also could be thought of the end of civilization and the end of human life.
Yes, well, those are two big things that were not in our hand. We couldn't do that any time in all of history. We were protected in our impotence on destruction. We have also got a liberating capability. We're coming to the end time. We're coming to a time of liberation of the whole human society and a great jump up moment and something like that, which would bring me around also now. We've only got a couple minutes left to take that out of the context of the Judaic tradition or even the Christian meditations on that kind of thing to Islam. And you got, as I understand, you understand it, the Shia is something that has a thing called the 12th Imam, the hidden Imam, a prophetic view of the world, that the period is to appear to bleed like the Messianic tradition in the Jewish tradition.
And we have other religions.
Is there a difference between the Shia and the Sunni? It's the Shia that has faith in this idea of a hidden imam who will be marking the end time or the leadership, Messianic leadership of the world. Is it have any meaning in real terms? We would tend to poo-poo it, but does that have any meaning until the division between the two branches of Islam?
Well, it may have some, but that's not the major difference now. But let me say, Harold, that given what you just said, which is true, this kind of thought, you can find this kind of thought in many, many religions. You could almost be another guru from what you've just said.
No, I'm not trying. That's just the intellectual community They're having a conference this week in about the fact we have a capability of liberating the human society that we haven't had
material. Or destroying it.
We didn't have the possibility to destroy it totally. We had one power could do the other. We didn't have, and we haven't had the ability to have a have-like way of being for everybody, everybody could be involved materialistically in the things that make for the good life or modern life. We didn't have that capability either. We have both now. They're there before us. We haven't bothered to come up with a system that serves the whole in a systems way, in a liberating way. So that's the context in which a lot of these other kind of stories would be maturing. But the division between Shia and Sunni, you don't think that's important on that idea of the 12th Imam or the hidden Imam?
As of right now, that's not of major importance in the gospel.
Okay, metaphorically then. Do we live at a time of qualitative? Are we living at the end times now in the evolutionary process of Homo sapien? Living in those times? It's coming up on the radar of many intellectual quarters that we are living at a time of qualitative transformation.
Well, asking me, if we're living
in the end times,
yes,
yeah.
I would say no.
You would, okay,
all right,
okay,
now,
fair enough.
But of course. Mm-hmm. My view, is no better and no worse necessarily than the opposite.
Yeah,
view.
Right.
And why don't I? Why do I say I don't believe it?
Yeah.
Probably because I'm too optimistic to want to believe it.
Spell that out if you can. Too optimistic. I
don't want to believe
you
it.
You don't want to believe that the end.
That's probably the reason.
Can you accept
there's no evidence for it.
There's evidence for the destruction of the whole species
there's
at
evidence
our hands,
for, no,
is there not?
There, yes.
There's evidence. Have you looked
there's
at that
evidence,
modeling?
There's evidence for the possibility.
No, the capability is different than possibility. Capability technologically of destroying the species with the weapons of mass. Do you think that's the case? Wasn't the case in the Second World War?
No.
Wasn't the case just yesterday?
Listen.
Is now. There's been a change in the level of capability. There would be an adverse side on this positive side. Possibly.
Because we have the capability, mm-hmm. which I agree with,
mm-hmm.
we have the capability.
Which we have never had.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe that's good and maybe that's not.
Mm-hmm.
But we have the capability.
Mm-hmm.
But because we have the capability doesn't mean that we're going to utilize that capability to accomplish a fact. Look, I have and you have the capability in many ways to go out and kill somebody.
Mm.
We have that capability.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean we're going to do it.
Mm. Yeah.
So then it's a question of, are we or aren't we? And so if you ask me, as you did, do I think that we are now approaching or at the time of the end times? I say no.
Okay.
Now, someone else may say yes.
One of the problems in this universe and all other parallel universes, possibly with string theory, is we have a limitation of time. We've run out of time, Matt Harden. We don't have any more time.
Harold,
so
it's always a pleasure to be here with you.
It's always a pleasure with you. Thank you for coming in. And thank you for coming in. Your pleasure to have the perceptions of a major scholar, as you've been able to see. Norton Mezvinsky is also a very good friend, and he's also somebody that everyone should read in that last, but the book, just quick.
Raymond Baker, One Islam, Many Islamic Worlds.
Everybody go out and get it. You couldn't do better, right? Thanks, Norton. Thanks very much for viewing. Coming back again tomorrow. That's it for now. Thanks again, Martin. So good to see you always. We got to get together more.
Okay.
I got a new dog you have to
All right, good. Okay, fine.
Good night. We'll see you tomorrow.
Okay. All right, Harold. I think that was okay, Harold.
Yeah, well, you're something else, man.